Good evening, aspirants. Welcome to the Target 2020 series by Shankar IAS Academy. In this video, we will discuss 50 important topics belonging to the current affairs of September 2019 from the prelims perspective. These topics have been sourced from the Hindu newspaper, Business Standard, Live Mint, and also from government sources like Press Information Bureau. And the content for these topics have been sourced from reliable government sources like ministry websites, e-gazette, PIB, etc. And these are the 50 topics which we have chosen from September 2019. The PDF link for this session is given in the description box and also in the comment section. Let us move on to the first question discussion. The first question for the September series is based on Amazon Forest. The Amazon Forest or the Amazon Rainforest was in news because of the forest fires that happened in August to September 2019. The Amazon Rainforest is the largest intact forest in the world. In other words, it has the largest continuous tropical forest in the world. And even the Food and Agriculture Organization notes that the Amazon rainforest is twice the size of India. It is home to more than 24 million people in Brazil alone. And it includes hundreds of thousands of indigenous people belonging to 180 different groups of the forest. So whether it is confined to one country? No. It covers 2.6 million square miles and it is extended over 9 countries of South American continent. So the second half of the first statement is correct. It is present in South America. Now let us see whether it is spread across all the countries in South American continent. See, a major part, even almost 60% of the Amazon rainforest is spread across northwestern parts of Brazil. So that means second statement is correct. You can clearly see this in this map also. In addition to Brazil, the whole of Peru and even the southern Colombia share less than 25% of the Amazon rainforest. Then the other countries other than Brazil, Peru and Colombia, where the territory of Amazon rainforest extends, are to Bolivia, then to the east of Ecuador, then it spreads across Venezuela, Guyana, Suriname, and also it is spread to the north of French Guiana. This French Guiana is an overseas territory of France. You can see in this map that how beautifully the Amazon River, which is the second longest river in the world, meanders through the dense foliage of Amazon forest. And it has a biodiversity. The region is home to 10% of all plants and animal species that are known on Earth. And there are approximately 40,000 species of plants and more than 400 mammals, with almost 1,300 different variety of birds. And it also has an insect population in the millions. So you can see that it has diverse biodiversity. In addition to this, Amazon also plays an essential role in helping to control the planet's atmospheric carbon levels. The Amazon basin stores approximately 100 billion metric tons of carbon. If deforestation of this forest is carried out, then it may release significant amounts of carbon and it will have catastrophic consequences around the world. There is one another importance of this forest, that this forest is often regarded as the lungs of the earth, because it is believed that this rainforest produces more than 20% of the world's oxygen. So that means this rainforest is very much important to the world. But unfortunately, according to the conservation organizations, in the last 40 years, the Brazilian Amazon itself has lost more than 80% of the rainforest. This loss is due to the threats like illegal logging, soy plantations, then cattle ranching, etc. And then, as we saw in the beginning, this forest is also prone to forest fires. So conserving this rainforest is important. Now, coming to the first statement, it mentions this Amazon forest spread across all the countries in South America. But already we saw that it is spread across only 9 countries of South America. So it is not spread across all the countries, because countries like Chile, Argentina are also present in South America, but this rainforest is not extended to these countries. So this statement is incorrect. Here the question asks for the incorrect statement. So before marking the final answer, always have a look at whether the question asks for the correct statements or the incorrect statements. Here the correct answer becomes option A, one only. And additionally, remember that major part of this forest is spread across Brazil only. And in the second place is Peru, which contains 10% of the Amazon rainforest. Now this next question is based on Convention on Cybercrime. The question asks, this Convention on Cybercrime of 2001 of the Council of Europe is the only binding international instrument on cybercrime. This convention was in news because the Council of Europe was asking India to join the convention. So that means India is still not a signatory to this convention. And in the August-September period, a national conference on cybercrime investigation and forensics was organized by the CBI, that is Central Bureau of Investigation. In this conference also, this convention was discussed. So that was in news at that time. And additionally, Peru, which is a non-member of Council of Europe, joined this convention in August 2019. So for three instances, this topic was on news. And this Convention on Cybercrime of 2001, which is a convention of Council of Europe, it is also known as Budapest Convention. So the correct answer to this question is option C only. And this international instrument is the only binding international instrument on cybercrime. And it serves as a guideline for any country that is developing comprehensive national legislation against cybercrime. Further, it also serves as a framework for international cooperation between the state parties to this treaty. And this convention, that is the Budapest Convention, is supplemented by a protocol on xenophobia and racism committed through computer systems. This protocol is also framed by the Council of Europe. So the convention is the first international treaty on crimes that are committed via the internet and other computer networks. It deals particularly with the infringement of copyright. It deals with computer-related fraud, child pornography, and also violations of network security. It also contains a series of powers and procedures such as the search of computer networks and interception. Its main objective is to pursue a common criminal policy which is aimed at the protection of society against cybercrime. And this will be done by adopting appropriate legislation and by fostering the international cooperation. And from Indian point of view, what you need to know is India did not ratify this convention and nor did we sign this convention yet. But our neighbor Sri Lanka has acceded to this convention. Now the other conventions which are mentioned in this question, Singapore Convention, Marpol Convention, Osaka Track, we already discussed these conventions in our July and August series. So just remember that Singapore Convention is based on mediation and it is a UN convention and India is a signatory to this convention. And Marpol Convention, it is the main international convention covering prevention of pollution of the marine environment by ships, which happens from operational causes or accidental causes. And India is a signatory to this convention. And as we just saw, Budapest Convention is related to cybercrime. Then the Osaka Track, it is a framework that creates a set of international rules enabling the free movement of data across borders. So Osaka Track is based on digital economy. And remember, India is not a signatory. So Singapore Convention is based on mediation, Marpol Convention is based on marine pollution, Budapest Convention is based on cybercrime, and Osaka Track is based on digital economy. First two, India is a signatory, and the second two, India is not a signatory. Now let us take the next question. This question is based on Eastern Economic Forum. The first statement states, it is an initiative under India's Act East policy. So that means it mentions that it is an Indian initiative. Now to see whether this is a correct statement or not, you should first remember that why this Eastern Economic Forum was in news. It was in news because the Indian Prime Minister was invited by the Russian Prime Minister to be the chief guest of the forum in 2019. So from this, it is clear that it is not an Indian initiative. So this means first statement is incorrect. We know that India's Look East policy has been a major pillar of our foreign policy since the early 1990s. But in the second half of 2014, the Look East policy was upgraded to the Act East policy. And this policy focuses on the extended neighborhood in the Asia-Pacific region. And the policy was originally conceived as an economic initiative, but later it gained political, strategic and cultural dimensions. And the key principles and objectives of Act East policy is to promote economic cooperation, cultural ties, and to develop strategic relationship with countries in the Asia-Pacific region through continuous engagement at different levels like bilateral, regional, and multilateral levels. And this will be carried out by providing enhanced connectivity to the Indian states of Northeastern region with other countries in our neighborhood. So that means the second statement also talks about India's Act East policy only. But this Eastern Economic Forum is an initiative of Russia. It is not an initiative of India. So both the statements are incorrect. So the correct answer is option D, neither one nor two. This Eastern Economic Forum was established by Russian president in the year 2015. And there are two main objectives of this forum. First is to support the economic development of Russia's Far East. And secondly, to expand the international cooperation in the Asia-Pacific region. The forum's business program includes a number of business dialogues with leading partner countries in the Asia-Pacific region and also in the ASEAN, that is Association of Southeast Asian Nations. And here you should note that India is not a prominent investor in the region. The prominent investors are China, Japan, Republic of Korea, Australia, New Zealand and Vietnam. Now let us take the next question. This question is based on Kodava community. Three statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. The first statement is they are the original inhabitants of Nilgiris of Tamil Nadu. Now this statement is incorrect because the Kodavas are the dominant community in the Kodagu region. In fact, the Kodavas are the original inhabitants of the Kodagu region. The Kodagu region is nothing but the Coorg, which you would have often heard. It is one of the least populated districts of Karnataka. This region is known for its coffee and also serene locations, and it is most importantly known for its brave warriors. This region is situated on the Western Ghats, and as we know, it is one of the most beautiful hill stations. And remember that Coorg or Kodagu is also the birthplace of River Kaveri, and the River Kaveri originates from Talakaveri, which is present in this region only. And these Kodavas belong to a very old civilization. They have a lifestyle and culture of their own, which is very special and attractive. Their language is known as Kodavatak. This language is a combination of Kannada, Tamil and Malayalam. But Kannada is the most influential of these three languages. And remember, this language does not have a script. And here you should note that already there is a request to the central government that this language should be added to the list of scheduled languages which are present in the 8th schedule of the constitution. So what about the occupation and tradition of this community? Kodavas have a martial tradition and hunting had been incorporated into their way of life. This community has contributed great personalities like Field Marshal Kariyappa and General Timmaya to our nation. So you can remember that Field Marshal Kariyappa belonged to this community and you can link it with the martial tradition. So the first half of the second statement is correct. They have martial tradition. Now, since they have a martial tradition, even the traditional festivals of Kodavas are associated with either agriculture or military nature of the people. And one such festival is Kailpo. It is the festival of arms, and in that day, all the arms are removed, polished and worshipped. So that means the third statement is correct. Now we already saw that the first half of the second statement is correct. Now the second half is they are exempted from obtaining arms licenses. Just now we saw that this community has a martial tradition and they have a festival of arms also. And there is one more speciality to this community. This community have been getting the exemption of obtaining arms license since the British era. The British had granted the exemption for the people of Coorg to possess firearms in 1861 itself. And then the central government after independence has provided the exemption in the rules issued under the Arms Act of 1959. Now, this community was in news because the exemption has been extended for a period of 10 years till 2029. So that means until 2029, they are exempted from obtaining license for the arms. So second statement is also correct. Some sources say that Kodavas are the only community in the country who are exempted from obtaining arms licenses. So, Kodavas are getting the exemption for over a century, and the reason given for this is that firearms were never misused by the community for crimes or anti-national or anti-state activities, and that is why they are given exemption. This is the reason given by the government. So, the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 and 3. Now, this next question is based on Law Commission of India. And we have to choose the correct statements. First statement is, it is a non-permanent constitutional body. So here we have to focus on two words. One is non-permanent and the second one is constitutional body. But if you see the second statement, it states it is reconstituted every 5 years since independence. So The first statement and second statement are contradictory because if it is reconstituted, then it is not permanent. Yes, it is not a permanent body because every 3 years, normally, this commission has been reconstituted. So that means it is a non-permanent body and it is also not a constitutional body because it is not constituted based on any statute or law. Rather, it is constituted based on the order of the government. So both the statements are incorrect. Now, based on the given options, you can say that statement 3 is correct because you have to eliminate 1 and 2 in the options. The third statement states the first law commission before independence was constituted under the chairmanship of Lord Macaulay. It is correct because the statement mentions as before independence. So law commission existed even before independence. The first law commission before independence was established in 1834 under the Charter Act of 1833. And it was constituted under the chairmanship of Lord Macaulay. And this commission at that time recommended codification of penal code, codification of criminal procedure code and few other matters also. And even before independence, the second, third and fourth law commissions were also constituted. So after independence, there were also demands in parliament and outside for establishing a central law commission. So the government of India reacted favorably and established the first law commission of independent India in 1955. So you have to pay attention here. The first law commission of independent India is constituted in 1955. But there was also law commission before independence. And the first chairman of the first commission of independent India was the then Attorney General of India, Mr. M.C. Setalwad. And after that, 21 more law commissions have been appointed by the government. And recently, law commission was in news because the 22nd law commission has been constituted. And the 22nd law commission constituted for a period of 3 years from the date of publication of the order of the government in the official gazette. So remember, the tenure of law commission is 3 years. And till 21st law commission, after every 3 years, the law commission was constituted. But the recent law commission, that is the 22nd law commission, has been constituted very recently in 2020 only, even though the tenure of 21st law commission ended in 31st August of 2018 itself. So the 22nd law commission was not constituted in 2018 or 2019. Rather, it has been constituted very recently in February 2020 only. Now, this next question is based on Fall Army Bomb, or in short, FAW. It was in news because the state of Tamil Nadu was affected by this. And even the states like Karnataka, Telangana and Andhra Pradesh had endured the menace of Fall Army Bomb. Now, here four statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. Now, in this, if you see option C, it mentions a spyware that exploited the vulnerability in WhatsApp. Now, you know that this statement is talking about Pegasus, so you can eliminate option C. Now, this Fall Army Bomb was in news as its infestation resulted in crop loss of 20 crore in the state of Mizoram last year. So, if you have heard about the news, you can easily arrive at the option, which is option B. It mentions that an polyphagous pest that caused damages to maize plantation in India. See, this Fall Army Bomb's scientific name is Spodoptera frugiperda. It is an insect when fully grown. It is native to tropical and subtropical regions of Americas and it is an invasive species. And more importantly, the larval stage of this Fall Army Bomb causes more damage because it feeds on more than 80 plant species including maize, rice, sorghum, millet, vegetable crops, cotton, etc. And that is why it got the name Fall Army Bomb, because it causes damages at the larval stage. Actually, it is a caterpillar, not a worm. Now, here the word polyphagous means it feeds on many different species of plants, which we just saw. And it can also produce on many different species of plants. And this means it can rapidly spread across many environments and cropping systems, and it is not restricted by any diet. Now, this infestation is a big problem because it poses a threat to the food security. It was first detected in the Central and West Africa in the early 2016. But if you see, end of July 2018, it was detected in Yemen and in India. And it was the first occurrence in Asia. And after that, it was detected in Bangladesh, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, Thailand, China. And then very recently, in March 2020, it has been detected in Timor-Leste. So this means that this FAW is a dangerous transboundary pest with a high potential to spread continually due to its natural distribution capacity. And it also spreads due to its flying ability And sometimes it is even unintentionally passed on through the produce in an international trade also. Now, with respect to India, this FAW was first identified in Karnataka. Now, when we talk about such kind of infestations, we should remember about the Integrated Pest Management Activities, or in short, IPM. It is an integrated strategy of pest control which aims at prevention of pests and its damage through a combination of techniques such as the combination of chemical, biological techniques, then new cropping system, then modification of cultural practices, then also through mechanical methods, etc. And one such measure is the use of pheromone traps, because pheromones are the chemicals used by insects and other animals to communicate with each other. So insects send these chemical signals to help attract mates and also to warn about the predators and even to find food. So this pheromone trap helps to lure the insects and pests. These pheromone traps are used for the monitoring purposes of FAW and not for controlling the pest. Once it is known that FAW is present in a region, then immediately appropriate integrated pest management measures can be taken. So remember that pheromone traps is related to luring of insects and pests, and it is particularly related to FAW. Now, this question is based on government schemes and projects related to women development, especially also the safety and security aspect. Now, in this, the Swadhar Grahi scheme was in news as it found the lack of security and unhygienic living conditions at the rehabilitative homes for women which are built under the Swadhar Grahi scheme. And this scheme is a scheme for women in difficult circumstances. That is, the scheme envisages providing shelter, food, clothing and health, as well as the economic and social security for women. It targets the women victims of difficult circumstances who are in need of institutional support for the rehabilitation so that they could lead their life with dignity. And this scheme can be availed by women who are in difficult circumstances, like the survivors of natural disasters, then prisoners who are released from jail, then victims of domestic violence, and even the rescued trafficked women or girls. So the first pair is correct, and it is a centrally sponsored scheme. Now, since pair 1 is correct, you can eliminate option C because the question asks for the correctly matched pairs only. Now, the second pair is Ujjwala Prevention of Trafficking of Women. Now, don't confuse this scheme with Ujjwala scheme, because Ujjwala scheme, or the Pradhan Mantri Ujjwala Yojana, is a scheme of Ministry of Petroleum and Natural Gas which provides LPG connections to women who belong to the below poverty line households. Now, this is a Ujjwala scheme. There is slightly a spelling difference, so while marking the statements, don't get confused. This pair is also correctly matched. This scheme envisages the prevention of illicit trafficking, and it is also for the rescue and rehabilitation of victims who were trafficked for commercial sexual exploitation. And this scheme is also a centrally sponsored scheme. Now, here we have also given you the main components of this scheme. You can take a note of it. Now, the next pair is Mahila eHeart. Now, this Mahila eHeart is a direct online marketing platform. So, this is also the correct pair. This scheme envisages to facilitate entrepreneurship opportunities online for women. The objective of this scheme is to educate women on various aspects of online selling and also for helping them to establish their own ventures. It is an initiative for women across the country as a part of Digital India and Stand Up India initiatives. So remember that the scheme for women which is related to Digital India and Stand Up India initiative is the Mahila eHeart. And this is an online platform which has been set up by the Ministry of Women and Child Development under Rashtriya Mahila Kosh. Now the last scheme is Sakhi. This Sakhi scheme is also known as One Stop Centers scheme. The scheme provides for establishment of one-stop centers which are intended to support women who are affected by violence. They could be affected by violence in a private or public space, or within the family, or within the community, or even at the workplace. So this pair is also correctly matched. So the correct answer to this question is option D, all the above. Now, these are the objectives of the scheme, and it is also a centrally sponsored scheme. Now remember that all these schemes are part of Ministry of Women and Child Development. So, in this question, we saw four schemes which are related to women. Now, let us take the next question. Now, this next question asks, repeal the 8th and save the 8th phrases that recently appeared in the news in the context of the affairs of which of the following countries? Four countries are given: Israel, China, Ireland, Bolivia. Now, remember that this phrase is related to the 8th amendment of the Ireland constitution, and it is related to abortion referendum and legislation of Ireland. Now, this was in news because there were anti-abortion protests and there were also campaign for free, safe, legal and local abortion in the month of September 2019. So, the correct answer to this question is option C, Ireland. Now, for your understanding, let us see about the 8th Amendment of Ireland Constitution. It recognizes the right to life of unborn child and therefore it bans abortion. This 8th Amendment prohibited abortion in almost all cases. And remember that Ireland is one of the few countries in the world which protects the unborn. But few years back, the Ireland Constitution was amended to allow women to travel to other countries to have an abortion. And it is said that around 170,000 women traveled mostly to Britain to seek abortion after the amendment. Then in the year 2013, the Protection of Life During Pregnancy Act was legislated in Ireland to allow for abortions if the mother's life is immediately threatened. Now, this was the case until 2008. So now you may have a question, what is this? Repeal the 8th, save the 8th. These are the campaigns by two groups, one which is supporting the abortion and the other group is against the abortion. This campaign surfaced when the abortion referendum bill was in place. So you can imagine that the pro-abortion campaigners were pushing to repeal the 8th Amendment on the grounds that Ireland's abortion laws are among the most restrictive in Europe. But those who are against abortion, they want to retain it. They argue that human life encompasses the stages from conception to death. But if you see, now the status of this 8th Amendment is that it has been repealed in 2018. After a referendum was conducted. In this referendum, around 66% of citizens of Ireland voted in support of abortion and therefore an abortion legislation was enacted. So as of now, Irish women are able to access a termination within the first 12 weeks of their pregnancy. Now here you should remember the recent Medical Termination of Pregnancy Amendment Bill of 2020, which was introduced by Indian Parliament. This new bill seeks to extend the upper limit for permitting abortions. It will be increased from 20 weeks to 24 weeks for special categories of women and it will be increased to 20 weeks for a normal person when opinion of one registered medical practitioner is needed. So try to relate these legislations. It will also help you to write a mains answer. Now let us take the next question. Now this question is based on School Education Quality Index and this index was released in September only. This index was conceptualized and developed in 2019 only. It was developed to evaluate the performance of states and union territories in the Indian school education sector. And the first statement states, it was prepared, compiled and released by Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India. No, it is not. The first statement is wrong. It is released by NITI Aayog and it was developed through a collaborative process including key stakeholders such as Ministry of Human Resource and Development, the World Bank and some education sector experts also. Now, since first statement is incorrect, you can eliminate option A and D. And based on the given options, you can say statement 2 is correct. Because it is present in all the options. It is correct because this index has two categories, outcomes and governance processes aiding outcomes. And these two categories have major domains and they have around 30 critical indicators in total. Now let us see whether statement 3 is correct or not. Kerala has been ranked first in the overall performance among the states and union territories. Now this statement is wrong because this index has grouped the states and union territories into three groups. One is large states, then small states and then union territories group. And Kerala is at the top rank in overall performance among the best performing large states. But whereas if you see Chandigarh has a score of 82.9% and it is at the top rank among the top performing union territories. So comparing these scores, you can easily say that overall in India with respect to states and union territories, Chandigarh is at the top rank. But if the question would have been about the large states only, then the statement would have been correct. Now also know that Rajasthan, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat and Assam are the best performing large states. And Uttar Pradesh has been ranked last in the large states category. Now with respect to the small states category, Manipur has been ranked as the top performer. Whereas Arunachal Pradesh has been ranked last in this category. Now with respect to union territories, Lakshadweep ranks the last. Now this ranking has been provided by this index because it aims to bring an outcome focus to education policy by providing the states and union territories with a platform so that they can identify their strengths and weaknesses and they can undertake the required course corrections and policy interventions. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. Now, this next question is based on Mukurthi National Park. Two statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. First statement is, it is a part of Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve. This statement is correct. This Mukurthi National Park is situated in Tamil Nadu and it is located on the high altitudes of Nilgiris. And thus, it is a part of Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve and also a part of Western Ghats. And remember that Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve is the first such biosphere reserve formed in India. And this biosphere reserve's portion extends over the states of Kerala and Karnataka also. Now, this Mukurthi National Park was in news because there was an increase in the population of Nilgiri tar in this national park. So that means second statement is also correct. The population was increased to 612 in 2019 when compared to the 568 in 2018. Now, from examination point of view, you should know some critical details about this Nilgiri tar. Remember that the Nilgiri tar is endemic to Western Ghats. And they are endemic to southern portion of Western Ghats, especially in the state of Tamil Nadu and Kerala. And also know that the Eravikulam National Park, which is located in Kerala, has the highest population of Nilgiri tar. And as we just saw, large population of Nilgiri tar is now also found in Mukurthi National Park. And additionally, remember that it is the state animal of Tamil Nadu and it can be seen in steep rocky cliffs. Now, for your reference, we have also given another tar species which is found in India. It is the Himalayan tar. And it is fragmentally distributed in the western and central Himalayas from the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir to the state of Sikkim. And you can see the protection status here. Nilgiri tar is an endangered species and both are placed in Schedule 1 of Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Now you can remember this, like Mukurthi National Park is a Nilgiri Biosphere Reserve and it has large population of Nilgiri tar. Now let us take the next question. This next question is based on Indigen project. Three statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. See, this Indigen program or project aims to undertake whole genome sequencing of thousands of individuals who are representing diverse ethnic groups from India. So that means statement 2 is correct. Now, the objective of this project is to create a pilot dataset to enable genetic epidemiology of carrier genetic diseases towards enabling affordable carrier screening approaches in India. The human genome datasets will also be utilized for prioritizing pharmacogenomics variant specific for Indian population. See here, the pharmacogenomics is a branch of genetics that is concerned with determining the likely response of an individual to the therapeutic drugs. This is for optimizing the therapy and for minimizing the adverse events. And this project is funded by CSIR, that is Council for Scientific and Industrial Research. And as we know, it functions under the Ministry of Science and Technology. And CSIR initiated Indigen project in 2019. And it is now being implemented by the CSIR Institute of Genomics and Integrative Biology, or in short, IGIB Delhi, together with CSIR Center for Cellular and Molecular Biology, Hyderabad, that is the CCMB. So that means first statement is also correct. So what is the use of such a project? See, the ability to decode the genetic blueprint of humans through whole genome sequencing will be a major driver for biomedical science. The benefits of this initiative include epidemiology of genetic diseases to enable cost-effective genetic tests, then carrier screening applications for expectant couples, which means that tests can be used to determine whether a healthy person carries a genetic variant that could be passed on to their potential future child or children. Then it will also help to enable efficient diagnosis of heritable cancers and it will help to do the pharmacogenetic tests to prevent the adverse drug reactions as we saw already. So apart from this, the project will also help in understanding the biological diversity of India and the sequenced genomes will enable in understanding and determining the unique genetic traits and the susceptibility and resilience to diseases. So that means from this benefits, you can easily say that statement 3 is also correct. Because on a whole, it also aims to generate data on genetic diseases and it wants to know how humans are susceptible and resilient to a particular disease. Here the question asks for the correct statement. So the correct answer to this question is option D, 1, 2 and 3, since all the statements are correct. Now this next question is based on base erosion and profit shifting, or in short BEPS. And we have to choose the incorrect statements. The first statement is, it refers to the phenomenon where companies shift their profits from lower tax jurisdictions to higher tax jurisdictions. This is the opposite of what is base erosion and profit shifting. So this statement is wrong because this BEPS is a tax evading practice that is used by multinational companies. We know that a multinational company usually has one head office in a particular country and there will be one or more branch offices, which is called as subsidiaries, and they exist in other countries. And ideally, the company have to pay tax for the profit which they earn. But what is happening is the multinational companies have developed certain strategies to avoid paying taxes by shifting their incomes or profits to their subsidiaries. And these subsidiaries will be located in the low tax countries. So the multinational companies are actually exploiting the gaps and mismatches which exist between different countries' tax systems. So here, the profits are shifted from where it is generated to a low tax location or a no tax location where there is little or no economic activity. Now, this practice is called as the base erosion and profit shifting because the tax base in one country is eroded and the profit is shifted to other countries. This strategy is mostly used by multinational digital companies. And according to the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development, that is OECD, the countries across the world lose around $100 to $240 billion a year because of this BEPS. And this amount is 4 to 10% of the global corporate income tax revenue. Now, this BEPS is a problem because it undermines the fairness and integrity of tax systems as the businesses that operate across borders use BEPS to gain a competitive advantage over the enterprises that operate at a domestic level. And moreover, when taxpayers see that multinational corporations avoid income tax, then it will also undermine the voluntary compliance by the taxpayers. And this practice mainly affects the developed and developing countries, which rely mainly on corporate income tax. So that means second statement is incorrect because it states it is limited only to developing countries, whereas it is affecting both developed and developing countries. So here the question asks for the incorrect statements and both these statements are incorrect. So the correct answer to this question is both 1 and 2. Now you may think whether there is any solution to this problem. Yes, there is. As a solution to this BEPS, an inclusive framework on BEPS was initiated by OECD and G20 countries. This is actually a modern international tax framework to ensure profits are taxed where economic activity and value creation actually occur. Now, through this framework, over 135 countries are implementing 15 actions to tackle tax avoidance and to improve coherence of international tax rules. Now, coming to India, we know that India is not a member of OECD, but India is a member of this framework, which is the inclusive framework on BEPS. And also remember that there was a previous year question in 2016 based on this BEPS. So whenever such kind of economic terms occur in news, you should know what it is. Now, let us take the next question. This question is based on nuclear weapon free zone. 5 treaties are given and we have to match with the zones which are given on the right side. Now see, nuclear weapon free zones are the agreements which intend to provide a legally binding framework to prohibit the use, then the possession and also the deployment of nuclear weapons in a geographically defined zone. So in simple words, we can say that a nuclear weapons free zone is a region in which countries commit themselves to not to manufacture or to acquire or to test or possess nuclear weapons. But remember that a nuclear weapon free zone should not prevent the use of nuclear science and technology for peaceful purposes. Now, this measure is an important disarmament measure to achieve a world that is free of nuclear weapons. And when we talk about nuclear weapons free zones, there are 5 treaties on regional nuclear weapon free zones. And these are the 5 treaties. And these treaties cover Latin America and the Caribbean, the South Pacific, Southeast Asia, Africa, and Central Asia. Now we have to just to see whether all these treaties are matched to the correct zone. Now the first treaty is Rarotonga Treaty. See, Rarotonga is the largest island in the southern group of the Cook Islands, which is present in the South Pacific Ocean. So if you know where this Rarotonga is, you can easily say whether it belongs to this zone or not. This is a correct pair. And this treaty has another name, which is the South Pacific Nuclear Free Zone Treaty. And it formalizes the NWFC in the South Pacific. Now, the next treaty is Bangkok Treaty. We know that Bangkok is in the Asian continent. But whether it is in Central Asia, no, it is in the Southeast Asia. So based on geography itself, you can easily say that this pair is not correctly matched. This Bangkok Treaty of 1995 is also known as the Southeast Asian Nuclear Weapon Free Zone Treaty. And this treaty is a nuclear weapons moratorium treaty between 10 Southeast Asian member states, which are under the auspices of ASEAN. So you have to remove pair 2 from the given options. If you remove 2, you will arrive at the correct answer, which is option C, 1, 3 and 4 only. The Pelindaba Treaty is correctly matched to Africa because this treaty is also known as the African Nuclear Weapon Free Zone Treaty, which establishes the NWFC in Africa. And Pelindaba is a city in South Africa. Now the fourth one is Tlatelolco Treaty. This Tlatelolco is in the Mexico City. So you can see that it is correctly matched to Latin America. And this treaty of 1967 is also known as the Treaty for Prohibition of Nuclear Weapons in Latin America and the Caribbean. There is one other name to this treaty, which is Opinal Treaty. Now, the Semipalatinsk Treaty is incorrectly matched because the Semipalatinsk is the location where 9 of the then Soviet Union's peaceful nuclear explosions were conducted, and it is in Kazakhstan. So it is in the Central Asian region. That is why this pair is incorrect. This treaty was framed in 2006. It is also known as the Treaty on Nuclear Weapon Free Zone in Central Asia. And it prohibits Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Tajikistan, Turkmenistan and Uzbekistan not to manufacture, acquire, test or possess nuclear weapons. Now this Semipalatinsk is known as Semi, so that is why this treaty is sometimes also known as Treaty of Semi. Now apart from this, when we talk about nuclear weapon free zones or status, you should also remember about Mongolia, because Mongolia self-declared itself as a nuclear weapon free state, and it was later recognized internationally even by the United Nations General Assembly. Then there are some similar treaties like Antarctic Treaty, Seabed Arms Control Treaty and also the Outer Space Treaty, which prohibits the use of nuclear weapons in Antarctica, the ocean floor and in the open space and the celestial bodies. So these are the information that you should know with respect to nuclear weapon free zone. Now this next question is based on an initiative known as Momentum for Change. The first statement is, it recognizes innovative and transformative solutions that address both climate change and wider economic, social and environmental challenges. And the second statement is, it is a United Nations initiative. The statement is correct. It is a UN initiative only, which is spearheaded by the UN Climate Change Secretariat. This initiative popularizes activities across the globe that are moving the world toward a highly resilient, low-carbon future. And this initiative recognizes innovative and transformative solutions, and it addresses both climate change and wider economic, social and environmental changes also. So first statement is also correct. Also remember that these solutions are called as lighthouse activities. The solutions are some of the most practical, scalable and replicable examples of what the world is doing to tackle the climate change. So here the question asks for the correct statements. Both the statements are correct. So the correct answer is option C, both 1 and 2. Whenever there is some initiative regarding climate change, you should take a note of it because you can expect a question in the prelims examination. Now here we have given you some of other initiatives of UN to tackle climate change. The Climate Neutral Now, then Marrakech Partnership for Global Climate Action, then Non-State Actor Zone for Climate Action. And just to know that all these initiatives supports and aims to implement the Paris Agreement of 2015. Now this next question is based on a report, which is the Travel and Tourism Competitiveness Report of 2019. And we have to choose the correct statements. First statement is with reference to India. So whenever you see a report or index, try to know what is the rank of India and whether India has performed well or it has not performed well. Now, this report is published by World Economic Forum and not by World Trade Organization. So statement 2 is incorrect. And this report ranks countries according to the Travel and Tourism Competitiveness Index, or in short, TTCI. This index has 4 subindex and they have pillars, as you can see here. Each pillar has different indicators. Now, according to this report, India has showed the greatest percentage improvement due to its overall TTCI score. And this score has helped India to become the only lower middle income country in the top 35 ranks. So that means this statement is correct according to this report, because India is ranked at the 34th position among the 140 countries which is ranked by this report. Now this report also commendably notes that India had the greatest improvements among the top 25% of all countries that is ranked in this report. India stands out due to the combination of rich natural and cultural resources and also due to strong price competitiveness. And this report notes that India has greatly improved in these indicators. So take a note of it. Now, according to this report, India accounts for the majority of South Asia's travel and tourism GDP. And India remains the sub-region's most competitive travel and tourism economy also. So these are the information that you should know with respect to this report and also regarding the findings of this report with respect to India. Now, from examination point of view, also remember that the World Economic Forum also publishes the Global Gender Gap Index, then Global Competitiveness Report, etc. Now, this next question is about NIRVIK scheme. See, sometimes when you know the full form of these acronyms, then you can easily answer the question. Now, the full form of NIRVIK scheme is Niryat Rin Vikas Yojana. And all these are Hindi words. So kindly noted that Niryat means export in Hindi and Rin means loan or credit. So from the given options, you can easily arrive at the correct answer, which is option B, a scheme which will facilitate higher credit disbursement to the exporters in India. So even though you don't know about the scheme, if you know the full form and the actual meaning, you can attempt the question and possibly you will get it right. So now let us see some facts about this scheme. Now, before that, the payments that needs to be made for exports are open to risk at all times. And many reasons like political and economic changes may block or even sometimes delay payment for the goods that are exported. In addition to this, the exporters have to face commercial risks of insolvency or default of buyers. So the exporters always face various risks. Now, throughout the world, each country has export credit insurance mechanisms, which are designed to protect exporters from the consequences of the payment risks. And it is also designed to enable the exporters to expand their overseas business without fear of loss. Now, for this purpose, in our country, we have the Export Credit Guarantee Corporation, or in short, ECGC. This corporation is wholly owned by Government of India and it functions under the administrative control of Ministry of Commerce and Industry. Now, this ECGC has over the years have designed different export credit risk insurance products to suit the requirements of Indian exporters and to suit the commercial banks which are extending export credit. Now, one such product which was introduced by the Union Ministry of Commerce and Industry through this ECGC is this Niryat Rin Vikas Yojana or the NIRVIK scheme. It was introduced in September 2019 only. That is why we are seeing in this series. And there is one another name for this scheme, which is the Export Credit Insurance Scheme. The purpose behind announcing this scheme is that it will facilitate higher credit disbursement. That is, it will enhance loan availability and it will ease the lending process. This scheme provides for high insurance cover. It also provides reduction in premium for small exporters and it also simplifies procedures for claiming the settlements. Now, if the insurance cover is high, then the exporters will benefit if they suffer from losses. And if the premium is reduced for the small exporters, then they only need to pay less premium amount for the insurance so that they can save some money. So these are some of the benefits of this scheme. And according to the Government of India, the borrowers in gems, jewelry and diamond sector will be largely benefited because of this scheme. So this was about the NIRVIK scheme. Now the option A talks about the Nirbhaya fund and option C talks about a scheme by Ministry of Tribal Affairs. And this scheme is the mechanism for marketing of minor forest produce through minimum support price and the development of value chain of minor forest produce. And the last option talks about the STRIDE initiative. We discussed about this initiative in our July series. Now let us take the next question. Next question is based on geography. It is about Atlantic Meridional Overturning Circulation or in short AMOC. Two statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. The first statement is AMOC is a large system of ocean currents that carry warm water from the tropics northwards into the North Atlantic. Now this statement is correct. This is the definition of AMOC. It is a large system of ocean currents and it is driven by differences in the water's density. And the water density is based on the temperature and the salt content of the water. And also remember that this Atlantic Meridional Overturning Circulation is also known as Atlantic Conveyor Belt. Now the Gulf Stream is a part of AMOC. In this picture, you can see that the Gulf Stream takes warm water to the Arctic region. Now, during this process, some water evaporates. Now, when salt water gets evaporated, it leaves out the salt. So, the salt content in the remaining water increases. And when the salt content increases, then the density of water increases. And the density is further increased by cooling of water when it reaches the polar region. Now, as a result of all these, the cooler water sinks into deep ocean. Now, the cold, dense water slowly spreads southwards towards several kilometers below the surface. And this process is called as the thermohaline circulation or the meridional overturning circulation. Now, in this thermohaline, thermo means temperature and haline means salt. Now, a part of thermohaline circulation which is happening in Atlantic Ocean is the Atlantic meridional overturning circulation. Now, after this, what happens is it comes to the surface in upwelling regions. Now, this cold water takes the heat and it becomes warm and then it again moves to the polar regions and thus it completes the circulation. Now, this process is important because it makes sure that the world's oceans are continually mixed. And this also ensures that heat and energy are distributed around the Earth. And it also aids in absorbing and storing atmospheric carbon also. Now, in the recent times, what is happening is due to global warming, the heat is transferred to deep oceans. The global warming also increases the precipitation and it causes melting of ice caps. Now, all these changes make the ocean water lighter and it reduces the sinking of water in the conveyor belt. Now, this leads to a weaker Atlantic meridional overturning circulation. Now, this weakening will have a profound impact on global climate system. But the recent studies have found that the rising temperatures in the Indian Ocean can help to strengthen the AMOC and it will delay its slowdown. And this was the news in September and that is why we are discussing it in this series. We know that Indian Ocean is one of the fingerprints of global warming and the warming in the Indian Ocean generates additional precipitation. Now this draws more air from other parts of the world, including the Atlantic also. Now this leads to reduced precipitation in the Atlantic. Hence, the salinity of water increases. Now, this saline water in the Atlantic moves to the north with the Gulf Stream. Now, this saline water will get cold much quicker than the usual and it will sink faster. And this will act as a start for AMOC and thus it also intensifies the circulation. So, in simpler terms, we can say that the warming of Indian Ocean strengthens the weakening of AMOC. So that means statement 2 is incorrect because it mentions that the warming of Indian Ocean weakens the AMOC. Rather, it strengthens the weakening AMOC. And here question asks for the correct statement. So the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. Now this next question is about UNESCO Creative Cities Network or in short UCCN. Now just know that this network was created in 2004. Its objective is to promote cooperation within the cities and among these cities. The cities that have identified creativity as a strategic factor for sustainable urban development are recognized by this network. And currently, there are 246 cities in this network and they work together towards the common mission, that is placing creativity and the creative economy at the core of their urban development plans to make cities safe, resilient, inclusive and sustainable. And this mission is in line with the SDG 11, which is about sustainable cities and communities. And also know from examination point of view that the cities are recognized under 7 categories which are given here. Now the question is, no city from India has been designated as creative city under the literature category of UCCN. Now know that so far 5 cities from India have been recognized by UCCN. 2 were recognized in 2015, 1 was recognized in 2017 and 2 were recognized in just 2019. And these cities are Jaipur, Varanasi, Chennai, Mumbai, Hyderabad. So just 5 cities only, you can remember them easily. And as you can see, none of these cities are from the category literature. So that means first statement is correct. Now the second statement is, recently Hyderabad and Jaipur were designated as creative cities. Now see, both have been recognized as creative cities. But did it happen recently? No. Jaipur was recognized in 2015 itself, but Hyderabad and Mumbai were added to UCCN in November 2019 only. And they have been recognized under the film category and the gastronomy category. See here, gastronomy is related to the art of food. So the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only, because the question asks for the correct statement. Now, also remember that Jaipur city was also granted the status of World Heritage Site by UNESCO in 2019 under the cultural category. And it was the last added heritage to this World Heritage List. It was added in 2019 only. So remember this fact also. Now, let us take the next question. Now, this next question is about Parker Solar Probe. This probe was launched into space in August 2018. And it was in news in September as it finished some of its phases. Now, this mission aims to probe the outer corona of the sun. And we know that corona is the outermost atmosphere of sun. So that means statement one is correct. And there is one another importance to this mission. That is, it will become the closest ever spacecraft to sun as it will fly through the sun's atmosphere as close as 3.8 million miles to the sun's surface. And it will be more than 7 times closer than any spacecraft that has come before. So this means statement 2 is also correct. Now know that this mission is a part of NASA's Living with a Star program that explores different aspects of the Sun-Earth system. So in the third statement, you can say that half is correct. NASA is involved. Now what this mission will do is the Parker Solar Probe will employ a combination of in-situ measurements and imaging to increase our understanding of the corona. And it will also expand our knowledge of the origin and evolution of the solar wind also. But the primary goal of this mission is to understand the science of sun. It aims to trace how energy and heat move through the solar corona. And it aims to explore what accelerates the solar wind as well as the solar energetic particles. So for this purpose, the probe has 4 instruments on board that are designed to study magnetic fields, plasma and energetic particles, and also to image the solar wind. Now the third statement states it is a joint mission of European Space Agency and NASA. Now this statement is incorrect because this Parker Solar Probe is a mission of NASA only. It is not a joint mission. But there is another joint mission of European Space Agency and NASA with respect to Sun. It is the Solar Orbiter mission. The Solar Orbiter is an international cooperative mission between ESA and NASA, and it will address a central question of heliophysics. That is, how does the Sun create and control the constantly changing space environment throughout the solar system? And the Solar Orbiter will be the first satellite to provide close-up views of the Sun's polar regions. So you can remember that Solar Orbiter will give the first close-up views of Sun's polar region. So NASA's mission with respect to Sun is Parker Solar Probe. And the joint mission of NASA and ESA with respect to Sun is Solar Orbiter. And here the question asks for the correct statements. And the correct answer is option B, 1 and 2. Now, this next question is about the reports or indices released by NITI Aayog. The question asks, which of the reports is not released by NITI Aayog? Now, we know that NITI Aayog is the premier policy think tank of Government of India, and it provides directional and policy inputs. And remember from examination point of view that Prime Minister of India is the chairperson of NITI Aayog. And the Minister of Defense and the Minister of Home Affairs and Minister of Finance, etc. are the ex officio members of NITI Aayog. Now, these are the indices which are released by NITI Aayog. Now, from this, you can see that National Institutional Ranking Framework is not released by NITI Aayog. Rather, it is released by Ministry of Human Resource Development. It was launched by MHRD in 2015. And this framework outlines a methodology to rank institutions across our country. So, the correct answer to this question is option C. Now, let us also see briefly about these indices. Now, this SDG India Index is created to comprehensively document the progress made by Indian states and union territories towards achieving the SDG targets. And this next one is India Innovation Index. It is for the continual evaluation of innovation environment of the states and the union territories and also to identify the challenges that needs to be addressed. Now, this School Education Quality Index, we already saw in this discussion what it is about. Now, this next one is Composite Water Management Index. This index is to bring a sense of data upkeep and water conservation in various aspects of water usage in the states and union territories of our country. Now, this State Health Index is to measure the annual performance of states and union territories on a variety of indicators such as health outcomes, governance, and processes. And then this one, District Hospital Index, is to track the performance of district hospitals based on outcomes. And the final one is State Energy Index. It is to compare energy accessibility, affordability, and sustainability across all the Indian states and union territories. So you can see that NITI Aayog releases various indices in different sectors. Now moving on to the 21st question of this series. This question is based on the Indian State of Forest Report of 2019. The question asks, this report provides information on forest cover, tree cover, mangrove cover, India's carbon stock, etc. Consider the following statements with reference to the findings of the report. Three statements are given and we have to choose the correct statements. Now see, first know that this report is published by Forest Survey of India. Because Forest Survey of India has been mandated to assess the forest and the tree resources of our country in a biennial cycle. And this 2019 report is the 16th report so far. Now here the first statement states, Madhya Pradesh has the largest forest cover area-wise in the country. Now this statement is correct. According to the findings of this report, Madhya Pradesh has the largest forest cover area-wise. It is followed by Arunachal Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Odisha and Maharashtra, as you can see here. But also know that when it comes to forest cover as percentage of total geographical area, then in this scenario, the top five states are Mizoram, Arunachal Pradesh, Meghalaya, Manipur and Nagaland. And according to this report, the states of Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh and Kerala are the top three states which have showed increase in forest area. And remember that the total forest and tree cover of our country is 80.73 million hectares according to this report. And this amounts to 24.56% of the geographical area of our country. Now since first statement is correct, you can eliminate option B. Now the second statement is mangrove cover has decreased in the country. Now this statement is incorrect because according to this report, mangrove cover has increased. The total mangrove cover in our country is 4,975 square kilometer and it has been increased by 54 square kilometer compared to the 2017 findings. And according to this report, the top three states which are showing mangrove cover increase are the states of Gujarat, Maharashtra and Odisha. But still remember that mangrove cover is the highest in West Bengal and it is followed by Gujarat. So second statement is incorrect. So you can eliminate option D also. Now the third statement is Gujarat has the largest area of wetlands within recorded forest area in the country. Now, according to this report, amongst the states, Gujarat has the largest area of wetlands within recorded forest area in the country and it is followed by West Bengal. So this statement is correct. So the correct answer to this question is option C, 1 and 3 only. Now also remember that according to this report, there has been a decrease of forest cover in the northeastern region of our country. And there are only two exceptions, which are the states of Assam and Tripura. All the other states in northeastern region have shown decrease in forest cover. Now let us take the next question. Next question is also based on a report, which is the Commodities and Development Report of 2019. The question asks, which of these institutions released this report? Now, the correct answer to this question is option C, United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. And this report was released in September only. And this 2019 edition is titled as Commodity Dependence, Climate Change and the Paris Agreement. This report highlights the challenges which the commodity-dependent and development countries face in the light of Paris Agreement. It states that the commodity-dependent developing countries may face challenges as they manage their natural resources sector because of the Paris Agreement. So based on this, this report also explores some potential benefits that might arise from climate change mitigation and adaptation. Now these are some of the other reports which are released by United Nations Conference on Trade and Development. Now let us take the next question. Now this question is based on Global Alliance for Vaccines and Immunization, or in short GAVI. Now GAVI was in news in September because the Prime Minister of Bangladesh, Ms. Sheikh Hasina Wajed, was awarded the second ever Vaccine Hero Award by GAVI. She was recognized for championing immunization both nationally and globally. Now this Vaccine Hero Award celebrates global figures whose dedication to Vaccine Alliance's mission has played a key role in helping GAVI and its partners to protect hundreds of millions of children across the world. So GAVI has said that the Prime Minister of Bangladesh has been instrumental in helping Bangladesh to introduce new vaccines and also to maintain basic immunization coverage at an 97%, which is quite an impressive one. Now remember that this award was instituted in 2018 only and in 2019, the second award was given. The first award in 2018 was given to an Indian businessman, Dr. Cyrus Poonawalla. He is the founder of Serum Institute of India and also the chairman of Poonawalla Group. He was the first person to receive this Vaccine Hero Award given by Gavi. In this context, remember that the Serum Institute of India was established in 1966 and it is one of the world's largest vaccine manufacturer by volume. Now let us take this question. The first statement is, it is an international organization created to improve access to new and underused vaccines for children living in the world's poorest countries. Now this statement is correct. This is the main mission of Gavi. And Gavi is an international organization that was created in 2000 and it is a global health partnership of public and private sector organizations that is dedicated to immunization for all. So this Gavi brings together public and private sectors with the shared goal of creating equal access to new and underused vaccines for children who are living in the world's poorest countries. And at present, Gavi vaccinates almost half of the world's children. Now, the second statement is, it is a joint initiative of United Nations Development Programme and the World Health Organization. This statement is incorrect because the core partners of Gavi are World Health Organization, UNICEF, World Bank and the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation. UNDP is not involved in this alliance. Apart from these partners, Gavi also works with donors, including sovereign governments, private sector foundations and corporate partners, NGOs, vaccine manufacturers, etc. So the correct answer to this question is option A, because the question asks for the correct statements. This next question is based on tribes. On one side, tribes are given and the other sides, the states where they reside has been given. And we have to choose the correct pairs. Now, one of these tribes, which is the Wancho tribe, was in news because a linguistic student developed script for Wancho language. And the student took 12 years to script the language. Apart from this, the student also got the script enlisted in the US-based Unicode Consortium for online use. This means that the language can now be used on internet across the world. Now, the first pair is Wancho, Arunachal Pradesh. This is the correct pair. The Wancho tribes majorly inhabit in the Longding and Tirap districts of Arunachal Pradesh. The Wancho tribes are culturally Nagas, but they are ethnically related to the Nokte and Konyak Naga tribes of Mon district and Tirap district. And the Wancho language, which we just discussed, belongs to the Tibeto-Burman family. Now, the Wancho tribe people are known for tattooing, and the prime festival of Wanchos is Oraya. It is celebrated between March to April for a period of 6 to 12 days with prayers, songs and dances. And in this festival, villagers also exchange bamboo tubes filled with rice beer as a mark of greeting and goodwill. Now, with respect to the Wancho language, you should know that the UNESCO's Atlas of World Languages in Danger has listed this language as a vulnerable language. Now, since this pair is correct, you can eliminate option B and C. Now, the second pair is Bodo or Boro from Assam. This is a correct pair. You would have heard about this tribe many times in news. And recently, even the Bodo Accord was signed. It is a correct pair because the Bodos are the earliest settlers in Assam. Now, to know more about the Bodo Accord, you can view our 28th January Hindi News analysis where we have discussed about this accord in detail. The second pair is also correct. Now, the third pair, Galo, Andaman and Nicobar Islands. Now, this pair is incorrect because Galo tribe belongs to the state of Arunachal Pradesh only. They do not belong to Andaman and Nicobar Islands. The larger sections of Galos are found in the West Siang and East Siang districts of Arunachal Pradesh. And their main festival is Mopin and it is celebrated in the month of April for prosperity and wealth. And this festival lasts for 4 to 5 days. And the society of Galo tribe is patriarchal and patrilineal with strong clan organization system. So the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 and 2. Now from examination point of view, whenever we discuss about any tribe, you should first know that whether that tribe is a particularly vulnerable tribal group or not. Now all these three tribes are not PVTGs or particularly vulnerable tribal groups and all these three belong to the northeastern region of India. Now to remember which of the tribes have been categorized as PVTGs, you can use one small trick. That is, only two tribes from two states in the northeastern region of India have been categorized as PVTGs. The two states are Manipur and Tripura and the two tribes are Maram Nagas tribe of Manipur and then the Riang tribe of Tripura. So other than these two, whichever tribes is given in the question, they are not categorized as PBTGs. Now for your reference, here we have also given you the list of tribes that live in Andaman and Nicobar Islands and their population as per the 2011 census. And we have also given which of these tribes have been categorized as PBTGs. Now let us take the next question. Now this next question is also based on an alliance, which is the Turtle Survival Alliance. Now this alliance was in news because it was a part of a joint program which involved wild restocking of two turtle species. The two turtle species are black soft-shell turtles and Indian soft-shell turtles. These two species, which breed in the ponds of two temples in Assam, were collected and they were bred in captivity. And later, they were reintroduced in the wild in the Pobithora Wildlife Sanctuary, which is situated in the state of Assam. And this process is called as wild restocking. And this joint program involved the Assam Forest Department and the Turtle Survival Alliance and also an NGO called as Hell Earth. This wild restocking program is an important measure for sustaining the turtles in the Brahmaputra river system. Now, from examination point of view, know that the black soft-shelled turtle is categorized as extinct in the wild by the IUCN Red List of Threatened Species. Now, this alliance was formed in 2001 as an IUCN partnership for sustainable captive management of freshwater turtles and tortoises. So that means statement 2 is correct. It is involved in the protection of freshwater turtles and tortoises. The first statement states it is an organ of United Nations Environment Program. It is incorrect because until 2008, this alliance functioned within the IUCN structure. See, this alliance was created because there was a rampant and unsustainable harvest of Asian turtle populations to supply the Chinese markets. This situation was known as the Asian Turtle Crisis, and in response to this, the Turtle Survival Alliance was formed. And this alliance also develops breeding programs for some species of turtles and tortoises that are unlikely to survive without well-managed populations other than the freshwater turtles and tortoises. Now, in the IUCN structure, it was recognized as a task force of the Tortoise and Freshwater Turtle Specialist Group. But at present, the Turtle Survival Alliance is a not-for-profit organization which is based out of USA. And it is a globally recognized force for turtle conservation. Now, these are the conservation actions taken by Turtle Survival Alliance. Restoring tortoise and turtle populations in the wild wherever possible. Then securing species in captivity through assurance colonies. Here, assurance colonies are the global network of linked breeding programs. And then the third action is the building of capacity to restore, secure and conserve species within their range country itself. So these are some of the actions taken by Turtle Survival Alliance. Now, with this question, we have finished the first half of the series. Let us begin the second half. This question is about Consumer Food Price Index. The first statement is CFPI is released by National Statistical Office, Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation. This statement is correct. The CFPI for all India rural, urban and combined is released by NSO only. And even the Consumer Price Index, that is CPI for all India rural, urban and combined on a monthly basis is released by NSO. Now we know that CPI indicates the average change in the prices of commodities at the retail level. That is, it indicates the inflation rate at the retail level. So CPI is a measure of change in retail prices of goods and services which is consumed by defined population group in a given area with reference to the base year. And as you know, there are three types of CPI. One is CPI urban, then CPI rural, and then CPI combined. And the CPI has all these six components. And just know that out of all these components, the food and beverage component has the highest weightage. Now, the second statement in the question is CFPI measures the change in retail price of items under the food and beverage component of Consumer Price Index. Now, this statement is incorrect because CFPI measures the change in retail price of food products with reference to a base year. But it does not cover all the items coming under the food and beverage component of CPI. The food and beverage component has 12 items or 12 subgroups, and CFPI excludes two items. These last two items, which is the non-alcoholic beverage and then the prepared meal, snacks, sweets, etc. So keep this point in mind. Here the question asks for the incorrect statement. So be careful before marking the correct answer. Here the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. This question is also a very direct question. It is about global infrastructure facility. Two statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. See, this Global Infrastructure Facility or GIF is a partnership among governments, multilateral development banks, private sector investors and financiers. And its main purpose is to prepare, structure and implement the complex projects which a single institution cannot manage. So that means first statement given here is correct. So this Global Infrastructure Facility is focused on banking infrastructure projects which have the potential to mobilize private investment. Or in short, we can say that it is a big institution with experts to fund very big projects. This GIF gathers money from funding partners as well as from private investors from the market. And on a whole, this GIF consists of funding partners, technical and advisory experts. The technical and advisory experts bring bankable infrastructure projects to the market. And as it is obvious, the funding partners provide financial assistance. And here you can see the funding partners. There are 5 countries and then the World Bank Group. Now, if you look at the second statement, it mentions it is an initiative of IMF and World Bank. This statement is incorrect because it is the initiative of only World Bank, not the IMF. So the correct answer to this question is option A, one only, since the question asks for the correct statement. Now, also know that in India, this Global Infrastructure Facility is supporting 2 projects. One is Solar Parks Program of Ministry of New and Renewable Energy. And then second one is Rajasthan State Highways Development Project. Now, let us take the next question. Now, this next question is based on Indian culture. It is about the Shondal dance. Now, this Shondal dance was in news because it created history by breaking the Guinness Book of World Records as the largest Ladakhi dance in 2019. So, this is a Ladakhi dance. It is obvious from the statement. And the performance of this Guinness record was held on the concluding day of annual Buddhist carnival, which is known as Naropa Festival. And it happened near the Hemis Monastery. Now, just know that this Hemis Monastery is a Tibetan Buddhist monastery, which is present in Ladakh. And it is situated on the west banks of Indus River. Now, this question asks, it is the traditional dance of Ladakh performed for the king of Ladakh. This statement is a correct statement. It is the traditional dance of Ladakh, which used to be performed by artists for the king of Ladakh on special occasion. And the Shondal is performed by Takshosma women dancers, who are the dancers of royal court. They perform this dance to praise and to greet the king and his family. So first statement is correct. Now just know that the Guinness record Shondal dance had a theme, which is the environment sustainability of Ladakh and the Himalayan region. Now here the second statement is, it has been recognized by UNESCO as intangible cultural heritage. This statement is incorrect. As we discussed in the July series, so far there are 13 intangible cultural heritage of humanity from India as recognized by UNESCO. And also know that there is one intangible cultural heritage from Ladakh, which is the Buddhist chanting of Ladakh or the recitation of sacred Buddhist texts in the Trans-Himalayan Ladakh region. It was given the status of intangible cultural heritage status in the year 2012. And the very recent intangible cultural heritage from India is the Kumbh Mela, which was granted this status in the year 2017. Now just know that there are 3 dances in this list. One is the Sankirtana dancing of Manipur, then Chau dance, and then Kalbelia folk songs and dances of Rajasthan. So here the correct answer to this question is option A, one only. This next question is about the Global Fund for AIDS, Tuberculosis and Malaria, or in short, GFATM. Now, this Global Fund was in news because India announced a contribution of $22 million to this Global Fund. Actually, India shares a sustained relationship with this Global Fund since 2002, and we donate money and also receive money at the same time from this fund. Now, the first statement in this question is, it is a global public partnership fund. Now, this statement is incorrect because it is a public-private partnership fund that has been designed to accelerate the end of AIDS, tuberculosis and malaria as epidemics. So, it is an international organization and this global fund mobilizes and invests more than $4 billion per year to support the programs, which is run by local experts in more than 100 countries. And if you see, the 93% of the money comes from the donor governments and the 7% comes from private sector and foundations. And that is why it is a public-private partnership fund, not just a public partnership fund. So this statement is incorrect. The second statement is, it was created to meet the Sustainable Development Goal target of ending the epidemics of AIDS, tuberculosis, malaria by 2030. Now, even though this target is also talking about the three diseases, this fund was not created to meet the SDG target. The target which is mentioned in this question is the target 3.3, which is by 2030, end the epidemics of AIDS, tuberculosis, malaria and neglected tropical diseases and combat hepatitis, waterborne diseases and other communicable diseases. And as we know, it comes under SDG target number 3, which is nothing but ensure healthy lives and promote well-being for all at all ages. This statement is incorrect because we know the SDG targets came into being in 2015 only. But this fund was created in 2002 itself in order to respond to these three deadliest diseases, which are preventable and treatable. And according to this global fund, as of the end of 2018, the health programs supported by this fund partnership have saved 32 million lives. And it also says that on an overall, the number of deaths caused by these three deadliest diseases each year has been reduced by 40% since the year 2002. Especially in the countries where this global fund invests. So the correct answer to this question is option D, neither one nor two, because the question asks for the correct statements and both the statements are incorrect. Now our 30th question is a geography based question. The question asks us to arrange these places in Indian Ocean as we proceed from east to west. Now, one common thing among these places is that you would have heard in news about these places with respect to naval ports and bases in Indian Ocean. Now, such kind of question is important because we have been hearing always that there is a rising Chinese influence in Indian Ocean. Now, as you know, the first one, Djibouti, is a country located in the Horn of Africa. And you would have heard in news about this country with respect to its naval bases, as US, France, Japan, Italy and China have naval bases in Djibouti. Now, the next one given is Assumption Island. This island is in Seychelles. It lies close to Madagascar and Tanzania. Now, you would have heard about this island because India and Seychelles agreed to build naval facilities in Assumption Island. But this plan hit a roadblock as the Seychelles parliament refused to ratify this plan. Now the next one given is Dukam, which is a port city in Oman. And as we know, it lies at the opening of Persian Gulf. And you would have heard about this Dukam port because India and Oman signed an agreement which granted India to use Dukam port for logistics use. And this port is closer to Gwadar and Chabahar ports. So it is strategically important for India. And as you know, Gwadar is a port in Pakistan, which is being developed by China under the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. And Chabahar is a port in Iran, which is being developed by India. So, Dukam is strategically important for India to contain China's influence in Indian Ocean. Next one is Changi. It is a port city in Singapore and it lies near to the major shipping lanes in Southeast Asia, like the Malacca Strait. Hence, this port is also important from geopolitical point of view. And even recently, India got access to this strategic port for logistics and refueling purposes. So in these maps, you can see all the four ports. And if you know that the Changi port is in Singapore, then you can easily say it should be in the eastern side. So from this, you can easily arrive at the option because we have to arrange it in east to west. So Changi should be in fourth position, which you can find in option 4. The correct answer is 4321, which is Changi, Dukam, Assumption Island and then Djibouti. Now let us take the next question. This next question is about Green Skill Development Program. See, this program aims at the development of green skills. Green skills contribute to preserving or restoring environmental quality for sustainable future, and it includes jobs that protect ecosystem and biodiversity and the jobs which reduce energy and which minimizes waste and pollution. And this program was launched by the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change for skill development in the environment sector and in the forest sector. So that means second statement is incorrect. It is not implemented by Ministry of Skill Development. And the first half of the first statement is correct. Now, this program will generate more employment opportunities for India's youth. It will also develop green-skilled workers who are having technical knowledge and who will be having commitment to sustainable development. So this will in turn help us to achieve the nationally determined contributions that is NDCs, then Sustainable Development Goals, and then National Biodiversity Targets, and as well as the Waste Management Rules. So first statement is correct. Also remember that these are the fields which are covered by this program, such as pollution monitoring, sewage treatment plant, mangroves conservation, etc., etc. And all the courses under this program will be compliant of National Skills Qualifications Framework. And at the end, the ministry will also give certificates indicating the skill levels to all the successful candidates. Now here the question asks for the incorrect statements. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. Be careful while marking the correct answer. Let us take the next question. Goldschmidtite, recently seen in news, is what among these following? An indigenous anti-collision technology for improving rail safety, an asteroid exploration mission by ISRO, a new mineral discovered from Earth's mantle, or a new isotope of gold? The correct answer to this question is option C, because a team of geologists have discovered a previously unknown mineral in a diamond from a volcanic site in South Africa. The team has found a dark green opaque mineral within the diamond, as you can see in this picture. This mineral has been named goldschmidtite. This name has been given in the honor of Norwegian geochemist Victor Moritz Goldschmidt. And the findings have been published in the journal called as American Mineralogist in the month of September 2019. Now, the geologists believe that this diamond was formed at 170 km underground in the Earth's mantle. Now, specifically, if you see, it was formed in the upper portion of the mantle that extends up to 400 km underground, which is called as asthenosphere. This asthenosphere is the main source of magma. See, what happens is, the intense pressure and heat in the asthenosphere transform the carbon deposits into sparkling diamonds. And also the rocks trap other mantle minerals in their structures. And during volcanic eruptions, these minerals, including diamond, can be pushed to the planet's surface. Apart from this, diamonds can also be found in the igneous rocks that line the volcanic pipe, that is the pipe through which the molten lava erupts. And in one such volcanic pipe only, the geologists have found this diamond, which contains an unknown mineral. Now, by analyzing such mineral inclusions in the diamonds, the scientists can understand the chemical processes that occur far beneath in the Earth's crust. The geologists have noted that this mineral has peculiar chemical composition. It has high concentrations of niobium, potassium, and the rare earth elements also like lanthanum and cerium. Whereas the rest of the mantle is dominated by other elements such as magnesium and iron. So the discovery of this mineral is new to scientists. So they believe that this discovery will give them an idea of the fluid processes that affects the deep roots of continents during diamond formation. So the correct answer is a new mineral discovered from the Earth's mantle. Now let us take the next question. This question is a direct question. It asks about E. Sanchit. Now first know that the full form of this E. Sanchit is E. Storage and Computerized Handling of Indirect Tax Documents. And this was launched on a pilot basis by Central Board of Indirect Taxes and Customs, or in short, CBIC. See, it was introduced by the Government of India for import cargo so as to reduce physical interface between the customs and the clearing agents. And thus, it is expected that this will significantly reduce import clearance time, as through this platform, digitally signed documents can be uploaded. So this eSanchit platform is mainly for paperless processing and for uploading of supporting documents, then to facilitate the trading across borders, which will reduce the precious time and it will provide digital easing. So that is why the correct answer to this question is option C. IT infrastructure used for paperless processing under single window interface for facilitation of trade across borders. This next question is based on a report, which is Global Nutrition Report. See, this Global Nutrition Report acts as a report card on the world's nutrition, not only globally, but also regionally and by country-by-country basis. And it is also a report card on efforts to improve nutrition. And the first statement is, it is published by Food and Agriculture Organization in collaboration with UNICEF. This statement is incorrect because this report is produced by the Independent Expert Group of Global Nutrition Report, and WHO is a member in this group. The first report was published in 2014 and the last report was the Global Nutrition Report of 2018. Now, the second statement is based on the finding of this report. It mentions that India is among the countries with largest number of child stunting and child wasting. This statement is correct because India is among the three countries with the largest number of children who are stunted. We know that child stunting means low height for age. And in India, there are 46.6 million children who are stunted. And the study also found that India is also among the three countries with the most children who are wasted. We know that child wasting is low weight for height. And India has 25.5 million children who have low weight for height. Apart from this, the report also found that anemia and stunting are the two forms of malnutrition burdens that exist in our country. And it also found that 51.4% of women in the reproductive age in our country are affected by anemia. Now, apart from this, we have also given you the global key findings for your reference. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 2 only. This next question is based on a topic which is most expected in prelims examination. It is based on the newly created post, Chief of Defence Staff. Two statements are given and we have to choose the incorrect statement. See, as you know, Chief of Defence Staff has the rank of a 4-star general. He will head the Department of Military Affairs, which functions under the Ministry of Defence. Apart from this, the CDS will also function as the secretary of this Department of Military Affairs. Just remember that this department was created very recently in the month of February 2020 only. Now, the first statement is CDS heads the Ministry of Defence. See, this is a very simple statement. We know that a ministry is headed by the union minister. So this is an incorrect statement. But in a hurry, in the examination pressure, you could think that this is a correct option. So be careful while reading these statements. Statement 1 is incorrect. The CDS will head Department of Military Affairs and not the Ministry of Defense. Now the second statement is CDS is the principal military advisor to the Minister of Defense, Government of India, on all tri-services matters. Now, this statement is correct. Apart from this, the three chiefs of Army, Navy and Air Force will also continue to advise the Raksha Mantri, that is the Minister of Defence, on matters exclusively concerning their respective services. And further, what you have to remember is CDS will not exercise any military command, including over the three service chiefs. He will provide impartial advice to the political leadership. And remember that CDS will also be the permanent chairman of Chief of Staff Committee. Now, as the permanent chairman of Chiefs of Staff Committee, the CDS will perform these functions. So, as a whole, what you have to remember is this new post of CDS is a reform in the higher defense management, and this would enable the armed forces to implement coordinated defense doctrines and procedures. Now, here the question asks for the incorrect statement. So, the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. This next question is about Mahanadi River Basin. You know that Mahanadi River is one of the major rivers of Indian Peninsula and it flows eastwards and drains into Bay of Bengal. Remember that Mahanadi River rises in the highlands of Chhattisgarh, especially in the Raipur district. And it flows eastward through Odisha to reach the Bay of Bengal. And the length of the river is nearly 860 km. And this news is often in news because it is one of the flood occurrence rivers in our country. And as we know, the famous Hirakud Dam, which is the longest man-made earthen dam of the world, was built across this great river only. Now the question asks, which of the following states share River Mahanadi Basin? Four options are given. Obviously, two should be in answer. So you can eliminate option A. And just we saw that it flows eastward through Odisha to reach the Bay of Bengal. So three, Odisha should also be there. Now know that the drainage basin is shared by Madhya Pradesh, Maharashtra, Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand and Odisha. According to NCRT, 53% of the drainage basin of this river lies in Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh itself, while the 47% lies in Odisha. So the correct answer to this question is option C, 1, 2 and 3. Now, this next question is about National Nutrition Survey or the Comprehensive National Nutrition Survey. Three statements are given and we have to choose the correct statement. This survey was conducted between 2016 and 18 by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare and UNICEF. So, a part of first statement is correct and it is also the first ever nationally representative nutrition survey of children and adolescents in India. So first half of this statement is correct. Now this CNNS is a cross-sectional household survey which covers children and adolescents, that is between the year 0 to 19, in both urban and rural areas across the states of our country. And this survey aims to measure malnutrition, including worm infestation and micronutrient deficiencies. And this will be done through biochemical measures such as blood and urine samples. So that means first statement is correct. It measures malnutrition. Apart from this, this survey also measures anthropometric data such as weight for age, height for age, etc. And the survey also focuses on details of non-communicable diseases such as diabetes, hypertension, cholesterol and kidney function in children and adolescents. And it also focuses on the prevalence of obesity or overweight and then muscular strength and fitness. Now the second statement of this question is, it is different from National Family Health Survey as NFHS collects data only up to 5 years of age, whereas NNS collects data of children and adolescents up to 19 years of age. Now this statement is wrong because NFHS is not limited to under 5 children. It is a national survey conducted in a representative sample of households throughout India, and it covers different groups such as child, adults, men and women, etc. So second statement is incorrect. So from that you can arrive at the correct answer to this question, which is option B, 1 and 3. The statement 3 is, as per the survey, Tamil Nadu and Goa had the highest number of adolescents who are obese or overweight. This is one of the findings of this survey. Apart from this, we have also given you some other findings of this survey. You can have a look at it for your understanding. Now let us take the next question. Now this next question is based on exchange traded funds, or in short ETF. It's a basket of securities that are traded on an exchange, just like the stock. So that means first statement is correct. Now these ETFs are in many ways similar to mutual funds, but ETFs are listed on stock exchanges and ETFs are traded throughout the day, just like an ordinary stock. So ETF can be bought or sold like stocks throughout the day. And ETFs can contain all types of investments, including stocks, commodities or bonds. Now these ETFs are gaining popularity because they are transparent, they are easy to use, and they have a low-cost way to create a well-diversified portfolio. Now to know more about ETF, you can visit our December 5 Hindu News analysis, where we have explained in detail about ETFs. Now, if you take the examples of ETFs, there are Bharat 22 ETF and Bharat Bond ETF. In this, Bharat 22 was an equity fund which invests predominantly in equity share and related securities. But whereas the Bharat Bond is a debt fund which invests in fixed income securities. In this, the Bharat 22 ETF was launched in 2014, and it is a fund which consists of 22 public sector companies which are listed on National Stock Exchange. So it has stocks of CPSEs, PSBs, etc. And such bonds have minimal credit risk and they are relatively safe to invest. But whereas we see the Bharat Bond ETF, it was very recently introduced and it is a basket of bonds issued by central public sector enterprises or undertakings or any other government organization bonds. And Bharat Bond ETF is the first corporate bond ETF in the country that is to be traded in the stock exchanges. That means statement 2 is also correct. It mentions that Bharat Bond ETF was launched by Government of India, which is the first corporate bond ETF in the country. Here the question asks for the correct statement. So the correct answer to this question is both 1 and 2. Now this next question is about Project Chaman. In this, Chaman stands for Coordinated Horticulture Assessment and Management Using Geoinformatics. Now, as this name suggests, Chaman is about assessment of horticulture crops using geospatial tools. And these tools include remote sensing, GIS and field survey. So that means first statement is correct. Now, the second statement is it is implemented by Mahalanobis National Crop Forecast Center, which is under Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. This statement is also correct. This center especially implements the remote sensing component of this project. And just know that this center has been established under the Department of Agriculture, Cooperation and Farmers Welfare. And it is established for application of space and geospatial technology in various domains of agriculture. So the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. Also know that using these tools, the area under horticultural crops is assessed and the production quality is forecasted under this project. Now, with the help of forecasting, the required number of cold storages and other infrastructure can be made ready. So that means this would reduce the post-harvest losses which are incurred by the farmers, and thus it will increase farmers' income. So that means it is in line with government's aim of doubling farmers' income by the year 2022. Apart from this, the project Chaman also helps to identify the best suited crops in the region, and this information helps the farmers to choose the most suitable crop. Now, apart from Project Chaman, there are also other government schemes which uses GIS and GPS tools for their effective implementation. For example, the PM Fasal Bima Yojana, then PM Krishi Sinchai Yojana, then Rashtriya Krishi Vikas Yojana, etc. Now, to remember that this Project Chaman is related to horticulture, you can use a small trick, because Chaman in Hindi means small garden. And we know that horticulture is the practice and art of garden cultivation and management. So just remember that Chaman means small garden, so that you can easily eliminate the given options. Now let us take the next question. This next question is about the militias which are present in different countries. Boko Haram, Houthi group, People's Protection Units. And on the other side, the countries which they belong to have been given. And you have to choose the correct pairs. The first pair is Boko Haram, Nigeria. This is a correct pair because Boko Haram is a radical Islamist group in Nigeria. Initially, it started against Western education, and later it became a full-fledged militia group. Even it launched military operations in 2009 to create Islamic State. This militia group wants to establish a state which is purely based on Prophet's teachings and through jihad. Now, this Boko Haram promotes a version of Islam which makes it forbidden for Muslims to take part in any political or social activity associated with the Western society. And this includes voting in elections, wearing shirts and trousers, or even receiving a secular education. So the first pair is correct. Now the second pair is Houthi group, Lebanon. Now this Houthi group is also known as Houthi rebels. This is a wrong pair because it is a rebellion group in Yemen. The Arab Spring of the Middle East caused transition of power in Yemen. But this transition of power was not smooth. So because of this, the rebel Houthi group took control of Yemen's north provinces, including the country's national capital, Sana'a. So you can eliminate option B and D. The third pair is People's Protection Units, Syria. This is a correct pair. This is a Kurdish militia in Syria. It was formed to protect and defend Kurdish inhabited areas in Syria. And even in the recent years, this militia group fought along US against the ISIS in Syria. So that means the correct answer to this question is option C, 1 and 3. Now with respect to militia groups, you can remember about the Salwa Judum, which belongs to India. It was mobilized and deployed as a part of anti-insurgency operations in Chhattisgarh. And it was backed by Chhattisgarh government because they were aimed at countering the Naxalite violence in the region. But later, the Supreme Court declared this group as illegal and unconstitutional. Supreme Court said that the deployment of tribal youths as special police officers, either as Koya commandos, Salwa Judum, or any other force in the fight against the Maoist insurgency is illegal and unconstitutional. And Supreme Court ordered their immediate disarming. Now let us take the next question. This question is about Bharat Bill Payment System, or in short, BBPS. The question asks, BBPS is an integrated bill payment system in India offering interoperable and accessible bill payment service to customers. Which of the following services is or are covered under BBPS? Now to answer this question, first you should know what this BBPS is. It is an integrated online platform for utility bill payments. It was conceptualized by RBI and then it was developed by National Payments Corporation of India, or in short NPCI. It offers integrated, accessible and interoperable bill payment services to the consumers. And it provides these services across geographies, which contains certainty, reliability and safety of transactions. So this BBPS is a one-stop ecosystem for payment of all bills. So what are the bills? It covers repetitive payments for everyday utility services such as electricity, water, gas, telecom and DTH payments also, that is direct to home payments. And these services come under the biller participant in BBPS. We'll see what do we mean by this bill later in the discussion. Now, this platform provides an interoperable services for consumers through digital channels and through network of agents to do a bill payment at one place, anytime, anywhere. So what are the channels through which these services are offered? The different means which are used are network of agents or retail shops or bank branches and even some digital channels like internet banking of banks, then mobile app of banks, etc. are used. And then it also allows multiple payment modes like card, UPI, Aadhaar enabled payment system, wallet, cash, and it also provides instant confirmation. Now, one important aspect of this BBPS is its key participants. The first key participant is the Bharat Bill Payment Central Unit. And as of now, RBI has authorized NPCI to be the Bharat Bill Payment Central Unit. It is responsible for setting business standards, rules and procedures for technical requirements and business requirements for all the participants. Then the next participant is the Bharat Bill Payment Operating Unit. It can be a bank or a non-bank, which is authorized by RBI. Now, this Bharat Bill Payment Operating Unit may choose to integrate either with the customers or with the billers, or even sometimes it may wish to participate as both, which means such Bharat Bill Payment Operating Unit will be integrated with customers as well as billers. Now, the next important participants are agents. Agents are the customer touch points and service points in the BBPS system. It is available in the form of agent outlets, business correspondent outlets, bank branches, collection centers, retail outlets, and other service points. And then another important participant is the biller. The billers are the service providers who shall receive payments from customers for services rendered. Now, by participating in this scheme, the biller will be able to receive payments from third-party channels for services provided to the customers. And there are a category of billers in this BBPS system. And these categories are specified from time to time by RBI. And as we already saw, electricity, telecom, DTH, gas and water are the service providers who come under this category of biller. But here, if you see the given options, it is municipal taxes, insurance premium, mutual funds, school fees, EMIs. Now here, remember that until September 2019, only electricity, telecom, DTH, gas and water services were offered. But in September 2019, RBI expanded the scope of BBPS to cover all repetitive bill payments, which included school fees, insurance premiums, municipal taxes, mutual funds, EMIs. So as of now, all these are covered under BBPS. So the correct answer to this question is option D, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Now let us take the next question. This next question is based on Asian Water Development Outlook. Three statements are given and we have to choose the correct statements. First, know that this Asian Water Development Outlook was initiated by the Asian Development Bank and the Asia Pacific Water Forum. And it is officially released by ADB only, that is Asian Development Bank. So that means statement 3 is incorrect. So you can eliminate option D. Now the objective of this outlook is to highlight the important water management issues in the Asia and also in the Pacific region. And its first edition was published in 2007, which underlined the need to address water security with a broader perspective. The second edition was published in 2013. It provided the first quantitative and comprehensive view of water security in the countries of Asia and the Pacific. Now, this 2013 second edition developed a few indicators of water security, which you can see here. And the recent edition is the third edition of 2016. This edition has refined the indicators which were developed for 2013 edition in order to provide a more reliable assessment of water security in the region. So that means statement 2 is also correct. It highlights water security issues in Asia and Pacific region as well. Now the first statement is based on the findings of this report or the projections of this report. This report has mentioned that by the year 2050, the groundwater use in the region will increase by 30%. And also by the year 2015, China, India and Pakistan will account for 86% of total groundwater abstraction in the region. Here abstraction means nothing but the extraction of water. Now apart from this, this 2016 third edition also mentions that by the year 2050, India will be one of the countries with the lowest per capita water availability. and the Asia and the Pacific is the global hotspot for water insecurity. It mentions that within the Asia and the Pacific region, India and China will be the regional hotspots for water stress due to their massive populations. So that means first statement is correct. Now, other than massive population, another reason for being a hotspot for water stress is that the 3/4 of groundwater in India has already been extracted. So the correct answer to this question is option C, 1 and 2. The report also mentions that India is one of the largest groundwater extractor in the world. And as per the available data, out of the total groundwater extracted in India, 89% was used for irrigation, 9% was used for domestic use, and 2% of groundwater was used for industrial use. So according to this report, the major portion of groundwater is used for irrigation in our country. Now, despite all these issues which are noted by this report, the 2016 report also shows a positive trend in strengthening water security in the Asia and the Pacific region. It is because in the 2013 report, there were 38 countries out of 49 countries which were assessed as water insecure. But in 2016 report, this number has dropped to 29. That is, only 29 countries out of 48 countries have been assessed as water insecure. Now, apart from this, from examination point of view, also remember that India is a member of ADB since 1966. Now, let us take the next question. Now, the next question asks, what is academic Lomonosov that is often mentioned in news? Now, since the word academic is mentioned here, don't think that it is either option C or D. It has been given only to confuse you. This academic Lomonosov is the first and the only floating nuclear plant in the world as of now. So the correct answer is option B. It has been named after a Russian scientist. And this has been developed by Rosatom. Rosatom is the Russia's atomic energy corporation. Now let us see some other information about this academic Lomonosov. It has two nuclear reactors on board. The reactors are capable of producing up to 70 megawatts of electricity and 50 gigacalories an hour of heat energy. And the operational lifespan of this floating power plant is 40 years. Now this floating nuclear power plant was launched in August 2019 from the city of Murmansk in Russia. And it reached Pevek in September 2019. Pevek lies in the far northeast region of Russia, called as the Chukotka region. Here, know that this floating nuclear power plant is not self-propelled. Rather, two tugboats towed the floating nuclear power plant to Pevek. And this floating power plant is expected to be commissioned in the summer of this year. Now, the purpose of constructing such a nuclear power plant is to provide necessary energy, that is electricity and heat energy, for the population of Pevek. Also, apart from this, Russia wishes to prove that operating floating nuclear power plant in remote areas like Pevek is possible. Now, remember that option A, mission to help understand the Arctic climate system, is nothing but the Mosaic mission. We saw about this Mosaic mission in our July 2019 Target 2020 prelim series. Now let us take the next question. This next question is based on Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana. Now before attending this question, let us see the meaning of the Hindi words mentioned in this scheme. You know that Pradhan Mantri means Prime Minister and Fasal means crop and Bima means insurance and Yojana means scheme. So it is a crop insurance scheme. So whenever you see the word Bima, you can relate that it is related to an insurance scheme. Now, this crop insurance scheme was launched in 2016 and it has replaced the National Agricultural Insurance Scheme and the Modified National Agricultural Insurance Scheme. So, first statement is correct. And this scheme is implemented by the Department of Agriculture, Cooperation and Farmers Welfare, which functions under the Ministry of Agriculture and Farmers Welfare. And even the concerned state, in coordination with other various agencies, is also responsible for the implementation of this scheme. Now, it is important to know about this scheme in detail. The first and foremost objective of the scheme is to provide insurance coverage and financial support to the farmers in the event of failure of any of the notified crop and the failure has happened as a result of natural calamities, pests and diseases. And apart from this, these are the other objectives of this scheme. Now, who are all eligible under this scheme? All the farmers growing notified crops in a notified area during the season who have insurable interest in the crop are eligible for coverage under this scheme. But apart from this, this scheme is compulsory for certain sections of farmers. They are the farmers who are in the notified area who possess a crop loan account or credit or Kisan credit card account. And these are the farmers to whom credit limit is sanctioned or renewed for the notified crop during the crop season. So statement 4 is correct. It is compulsory for farmers in the notified area who possess crop loan account or Kisan credit card account. Now, just now in the objectives, we saw that it provides insurance coverage against the natural calamities. So what are the risks covered under this scheme? This scheme covers yield losses due to non-preventable risks such as natural fire, lightning, storm, hailstorm, cyclone, typhoon, etc. It also covers yield losses due to flood, landslide, drought, pests and diseases. And then it also covers losses because of prevented sowing. That is, when majority of the insured farmers of a notified area have an intent to sow or plant and they have incurred expenditure for the purpose. But they are prevented from sowing due to adverse weather conditions. So if they are prevented from sowing, then they can claim up to a maximum of 25% of the insured amount. And apart from this, this scheme also covers post-harvest losses. We also saw in the project Chaman question, which also aims to cover the post-harvest losses. And these are the other risks which are covered under the scheme. Now, the next two statements, 2 and 3 statements, are based on the premium offered by the scheme. Second statement is a uniform premium of only 2% to be paid by farmers for all the crops. This statement is incorrect because there is uniform premium of only 2% for all the Kharif crops. And for Rabi crops, it is 1.5%. And in the case of annual commercial and horticultural crops, the premium to be paid by farmers will be only 5%. So there is differential premium rates. Now, since statement 2 is incorrect, you can arrive at the correct answer, which is option D, 1 and 4 only. Now, statement 3 is incorrect because before February 2020, the center and states shared the balance premium in 50-50 ratio. That is, they had equal contribution. But in February 2020, the center has almost halved its contribution to this flagship crop insurance scheme. Center has cut its share of the premium subsidy from the current 50% to just 25% in irrigated areas or crops. And the 50% has been cut down to 30% for unirrigated areas or crops. And this is to be applicable from the Kharif season of 2020 itself. In addition to this, there is one more change in center's share with respect to northeastern states. See, previously for all the states, the subsidy sharing pattern was 50-50 between the center and the states. But now for northeastern states, center's share of the premium has been increased to 90%. So keep this in mind. And apart from this, the scheme also mandates the use of mobile phones to get reliable, good quality and timely yield data. So availability of yield data will help in speedy settlement of claims of farmers. Then the scheme also provides for geofencing or geomapping of the region using the GPS. So that is all about this Pradhan Mantri Fasal Bima Yojana. Fasal means crops, Bima means insurance. Now let us take the next question. This next question is based on coral reefs. Now, the coral reefs were in news because due to algal bloom in the Gulf of Mannar, several hundred colonies of coral reefs died. And the algal bloom was caused by the greenish marine microalgae, which is called as Noctiluca scintillans. Now, this question says, coral reefs protect coastlines from storms and erosion, but they are facing several natural and anthropogenic threats. Which among the following statements are correct about coral reefs? Now, first know that coral is a living animal. Coral reefs are built by and they are made up of thousands of tiny animals called as coral polyps, as you can see in this picture. Now, the first statement is corals and zooxanthellae have a symbiotic relationship. This statement is correct. Zooxanthellae is a photosynthetic algae and most reef-building corals contain this zooxanthellae. These zooxanthellae live in the tissues of corals. See, as you know, a symbiotic relationship means one organism gives something to the other organism and it gets something back in return. So here, the corals provide the algae with a protected environment and also the compounds which are needed for photosynthesis. And in return, the algae produce oxygen and it helps to remove waste from the coral. And most importantly, zooxanthellae supply the coral with glucose, glycerol and amino acids, which are the products of photosynthesis. Now, these products are used by coral to make proteins, fats and carbohydrates and it produces calcium carbonate. So, that is how they share the symbiotic relationship. Now, the second statement states, in India, they are found in Gulf of Mannar, Sundarbans and Andaman and Nicobar Islands. This statement is incorrect. Coral reefs are not found in Sundarbans. In India, they are found in Gulf of Kutch, Gulf of Mannar, Andaman and Nicobar Islands, Lakshadweep Islands and in Malwan of Maharashtra. Now, since statement 2 is incorrect and the question asks for the correct statements, you can eliminate option B and C. Now, as the question mentions, the coral reefs are facing several threats which are both natural and anthropogenic. Anthropogenic means due to human activities. Now, here the threats include elevated seawater temperature, which could be due to global warming, then chemical pollution, nutrient loading, then industrial waste flowing into the sea, etc., etc. So these are the threats. But why there is a need to care about coral reefs? It is because they are an important food source for the people who live near reefs and they act as nurseries. So they are vital to world's fisheries. Healthy reefs also act as natural barriers. They protect coastal cities, communities and beaches from the pounding ocean waves. So that is why coral reefs are important. So there are many global initiatives such as Global Coral Reef Monitoring Network, Global Coral Reef Alliance and then International Coral Reef Initiative. They play an important role in monitoring the reef zones and they raise awareness in the public regarding the coral reefs. Now, the third statement is about one such initiative only, International Coral Reef Initiative. It mentions India as the founding member of this initiative. This statement is incorrect. See, this initiative is an informal partnership between nations and organizations which strive to preserve coral reefs and their related ecosystems around the world. And this initiative was founded in 1994 by 8 governments, which are Australia, France, Japan, Jamaica, Philippines, Sweden, United Kingdom, and USA. And India is not a founding government. And India is not a founding member. So that is why this statement is incorrect. But currently, the Ministry of Environment, Forest and Climate Change of Government of India is a member in this initiative. So the correct answer to this question is option A, 1 only. This next question is based on art forms and the states or union territories which they belong to. The first pair is Etikopaka Bommalu, Tamil Nadu. Now this pair is incorrect because it belongs to Andhra Pradesh. In this, Bommalu means toys and they are created in the Etikopaka village. It is a small village located on the banks of the river Varaha in the Vishakhapatnam district of Andhra Pradesh. This Etikopaka toys are made in this region and they are made with lacquer color and they are traditionally called as Etikopaka Bommalu. The toys are also called as lacquer toys because of application of lacquer coating. And the toys are made out of wood and then they are colored with natural dyes which are derived from seeds, lacquer, bark, roots and leaves. And the wood which is used to make the toys are soft in nature. And the art of toy making is known as turned wood lacquer craft. Now remember that this Etikopaka toys received geographical indication tag in the year 2017 under the handicrafts category from Andhra Pradesh. Now here the question asks which of the pairs given above are not correctly matched. So that means pair 1 should be in the final answer. So you can eliminate option C and D. Now the next pair is Kurumba Paintings, Kerala. This is also an incorrect pair. See, Kurumba art is a unique tribal art form found in the Nilgiris of Tamil Nadu, not Kerala. And this Kurumba painting are obviously the art form of Kurumba tribes who are from the Nilgiris of Tamil Nadu. The Kurumbas are a tribe of hunters and they are the medicine men. They believe that the art, that is the Kurumba paintings, are the work of their ancestors. And the art is related to tribal rituals. It describes various facets of tribal life in the forests of the Nilgiris. Apart from this, the Kurumbas are the forest dwellers whose social, cultural, religious and economic strength came from their immediate environment and the nature. So they also collect honey and sell the honey at premium rates. So it is one of their occupation. Now the Kurumbas have been categorized as particularly vulnerable tribal group from the state of Tamil Nadu because the developments of 20th century have resulted in the Kurumbas losing their forests, thereby they are losing their traditional skills also. But this art form has been revived by the C.P. Ramaswamy Iyer Foundation, which is present in Chennai. So the correct answer to this question is option B, 1 and 2. Third pair is correct. As we already saw, Shondol dance belongs to the Union Territory of Ladakh. It is a traditional dance of Ladakh. This next question is based on power generation in India. The first statement is, hydro energy is the least contributor to the overall power generation in India. Now, to answer this statement, first you should note the sector-wise power generation in India. The central sector forms 25.2% of total power generated, and the state sector contributes 28% of the total power generated. And the private sector contributes 46% of total power generated. Hence, the private sector generates almost but less than 50% of the total power generated in India. So that means statement 2 is incorrect. Private sector does not generate more than half of power generated within India. Now, hydro energy is a type of energy which is generated. And in India, 62.8% of the total power comes from thermal energy. And within thermal, coal produces 54.2% of the total power generation in India. Then other thermal fuels are gas, lignite and diesel, as you can see here. Then the next type is hydro energy. It contributes 12.4% of the total. And the renewable energy sources together constitute 23.5%. And the renewable energy sources include small hydro projects, biomass power, solar and wind energy, etc. And then the nuclear power contributes just 1.9% of the total energy generated. So from this, you can easily say that the least contributed is nuclear power and not the hydro energy. So the first statement is also incorrect. Now here the question asks for the correct statement. So the correct answer to this question is option D, neither 1 nor 2. This next question is based on trade receivables discounting system, or in short TREDS. Four options are given. Now first, know that trade receivables are amounts which are billed by a business to its customers when the business delivers goods or services to the customers in an ordinary course. And this TREDS is an electronic platform for facilitating the financing and discounting of trade receivables of the micro, small and medium enterprises. And this will be done through multiple financiers. And micro, small and medium enterprises are nothing but MSMEs. So the answer should contain MSMEs, which is in option D, an initiative of RBI of India to safeguard the interest of MSMEs. This is the correct option. This initiative was introduced by RBI in 2014. It aims to ensure regular flow of operational funds to the cash-starved MSMEs. It is done through raising funds by selling their trade receivables to the corporates. And on a TREDS platform, there are three participants: sellers, buyers, financiers. And only MSMEs can participate as sellers. Then corporates, government departments, PSUs can participate as buyers. And then banks and NBFCs can participate as financiers in TREDS. So remember that it is an initiative to safeguard the interest of MSMEs. Now let us take the next question. This next question is about ASEAN Way. We know that ASEAN stands for Association of Southeast Asian Nations, and it is a regional organization in Asia. It was established to promote political and social stability in the region, and it was established by the Bangkok Declaration. These are the member countries of ASEAN, and in this, Indonesia, Malaysia, Philippines, Singapore and Thailand are the founding fathers of this organization. Now, this ASEAN has fundamental principles, and these principles are based on Treaty of Amity and Cooperation in Southeast Asia of 1976. And these are the principles under this treaty, which also includes non-interference in the internal affairs of one another, settlement of differences or disputes by peaceful manner, etc., etc. These principles guide interactions among the ASEAN members, and it helps them to work with cooperation. Now, this question is about ASEAN Way. First statement is, it is the shared norms, principles and values governing the interactions of ASEAN member states. This statement is correct. It is a diplomatic engagement to solve the differences among these states. And this ASEAN Way has a legal foundation in the form of Treaty of Amity and Cooperation of Southeast Asia of 1976. So this ASEAN Way also works as a dispute settlement mechanism. That is, it manages regional discord through the modalities of norms and principles of non-interference. Then it carries out peaceful settlement of disputes. And it also follows a non-confrontational attitude towards conflicts. So on a whole, it means that the ASEAN members, through the principles of this treaty, weed out the cultural differences, political and economic differences, and they keep the ASEAN together. Now, the second statement is India's signatory to Treaty of Amity and Cooperation in Southeast Asia. This statement is also correct. India signed this treaty in 2003. Here, the question asks for the correct statements, and the correct answer to this question is option C, both 1 and 2. And now, successfully, we have reached the last question of this series. The question asks, recently Indian government launched humanitarian assistance operation to Sulawesi province of Indonesia. Which among the following is the name of the operation? Now the statement mentions about operation Samudra Maitri. Now you can remember that Samudra means sea and Maitri means friendship or rapprochement. This Samudra Maitri was a humanitarian operation by India to assist the tsunami affected Indonesia. In September 2018, an earthquake followed by tsunami occurred in the central Sulawesi province of Indonesia. And to assist the victims of tsunami, India launched this operation. India sent medical personnel and relief material to the devastated province. Along with this, three naval ships were also mobilized to carry out the humanitarian assistance and disaster reliefs. These naval ships are INS Tir, INS Sujata and INS Shardul. So the correct answer is option B. Now the first option is Operation Madad. Madad in Hindi means help, and this operation was launched by Indian Navy to assist the flood affected Kerala, which happened in 2018. The heavy rainfall and release of excess of water from Idukki Dam caused heavy flooding and it submerged many low-lying areas in Kerala. We all know that. So, Navy carried out disaster relief operations in Kerala. And in the same time, even the Indian Army launched Operation Sahyog to carry out rescue and relief operations in the flood-affected parts of Kerala. Now, the option C is Operation Vanilla. This was an operation launched by Indian Navy to assist cyclone-affected Madagascar. The cyclone Dian devastated Madagascar in January 2020. So, as a humanitarian gesture, Indian Navy sent INS Airavat to carry out humanitarian assistance and disaster relief. This relief mission was designated as Operation Vanilla, as Madagascar is one of the Vanilla Islands. So that is why this topic is important. Now the option D is Operation Nistar. See, in Hindi, Nistar means released from or rescued from. So this Operation Nistar is a rescue operation which was launched by Indian Navy. It was launched to evacuate the stranded Indians in the Socotra island of Yemen. In 2018, Cyclone Mekunu devastated Socotra Islands and this led to stranding of Indians who were living there. So to rescue them, INS Sunaina was sent by Indian Navy. And even geopolitically, Socotra has great significance, because it lies in Gulf of Aden and it lies close to Djibouti and it is close to major shipping lanes in Indian Ocean. As we already discussed in one of our previous questions, Djibouti has naval bases belonging to the countries of US, France, Italy, Japan and China. So maintaining good relations with Yemen has great significance for India. Now from examination point of view, let us also see these places from geographical perspective. You can see in this map that if we arrange these places from north to south order, the order is Socotra, Sulawesi and Madagascar. And from west to east, the order will be Madagascar, Socotra and Sulawesi. Also remember that Socotra lies north to equator and as we know, Madagascar lies south to equator. And even the Sulawesi lies south to equator. You can see this in this map very clearly. So that is all about the September series. From prelims perspective, aspirants are required to remember the names of operations and the recipient countries. So that is why we have chosen this question. With this, we have come to the end of Target 2020 series by Shankar IAS Academy for the month of September 2019. If you like the video, don't forget to like, comment and share. And do subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates related to civil service examination preparation.